Okay, variation is the thing which will give you the significant specific feature for construction contract. So there are so many other contracts under contract law, but how we are going to differ our construction contract is totally because of this variation. Yeah. So variation is giving, by variation it will be giving that kind of specific thing. And I don't think there will be any of the project in the construction industry without having a single variation. So together with construction contract, variation coming as an inborn effect. Okay, so variations are having that much of importance. So, and handling of variation is quietly a totally a responsibility of a contract administrator, because engineers or the designers or some of the other party will not take over the responsibility of variation. So as a contract administrator, if there is no contract administrator, then as a quantity surveyor you have to take that responsibility. Okay, so simply variation is changes to the contract. Nothing else, it is just a change for a contract. So contract in the sense, there will be an initial thing that you have agreed with your employer. So you might be agreed to do for particular set of design or set of drawing, and then again you will be agreed to do fulfill some kind of given specification with the given scope. Scope in the sense, you will be having rough idea how many round number of stories that you are going to construct, what about this substructure, what type of foundation are you going to carry out, and what are the finishes type, is there any other additional features to your project, something like that. So under that there will be agreed thing, but if you want to, or the if the engineer or the employer wants to do some changes for the agreed version, then it will be turned it as a variation. So normally for a contract, in normal commercial work, when there is a contract in between two parties, if one party want to do a change to that particular contract, then that contract become breach of the contract and it will become null and void. Because one party may, it says that one party is trying to breach of the contract, then at the end of the day there it will be become null and void, and there will not be a contract furthermore if one party tries to change any term or any kind of agreed version. But since our construction contract cannot predict at early stage, and since the inborn change in nature of the construction contract, we cannot go ahead with like that. So that is why within our contract document it has been given a particular section called variation, and that is why it is having that much of importance. Contract explain the rights and responsibilities of each party by variation, that relationship is going to be changed. So initially through a contract you might be agreed with you, both parties might be agreed that to fulfill some kind of responsibilities and to have some types of rights. But through a variation, those things can be changed, because initially what you have agreed to do will be changed because of this variation. Unless the contract administrator acts within the terms of a variation clause, there is no power to change what was originally agreed. So as I explained you earlier, for a normal contract, you cannot change normally. You cannot change what you have originally agreed, but construction contract, there is a power to the contract administrator to change, to implement the variation just because of our conditions of contract. Under variation clause, we have given that power. That is why we can implement the variation. Otherwise, we cannot change anything what we have originally agreed. It should be negotiated. So if we want to agree without variation clause, So just assume that there's no variation clause in our condition of contract, but we know while going on the construction there will be changes. In such a situation, if you want to agree for those variation, then you have to negotiate between two parties, you have to discuss in between two parties and enter into a new contract, because you have changed the initial contract. Okay, so now that is not necessary. We need to go for each and every time we need to go for a new contract, because our under variation clause, we know how to handle and how to give some actions when there is a change in our construction scope. Okay, when a contract is starting only with letter of intent without any contract, then it will be a problem. I know that you don't know what is letter of intent. Letter of intent in the sense, normally after tender procedure, employer will be sent his consent to the contractor through a letter of acceptance. So under letter of acceptance, what they are normally going to do is they are going to mention, okay, Mr. Bidder, we have accepted your bid document. So please start the work. We already have accepted your work as per our agreed conditions of contract. So that is the thing normally we are going to do under letter of acceptance. But there might be situation where you cannot issue a letter of acceptance because of some issues. Sometimes a site might not be available. Just assume that when you are supposed to do a new road construction, land acquisition should be done prior to start a project. Without getting the land from the public, you cannot start the road construction. But at the time of tendering stage, that land acquisition might not be happened totally. Sometimes some people might go to court and then you cannot acquire their land. So in such a situation, you cannot issue a letter of acceptance. Why? If you issue a letter of acceptance, then definitely contractor will come to the site and start the work. But under this situation, you cannot do such a work. Then what you are going to issue is a letter of intent, mentioning that start the temporary works. We will be paying you if you have done temporary work, but this is not the formal acceptance because of these issues. So under letter of intent, you are not going to come into a contract, but you just intend him that there is some kind of preference with you, but we are not sure whether we can start the project or not because of this reason. So in such a situation, if you have issued a letter of intent that if you are working only with letter of intent without letter of acceptance, then your formal agreement has not been done, prepared, or has not been established, then if you are going to do any variation, there will be a problem. Normally with letter of intent, you cannot go for variations. If you want to go for variation, definitely there should be a letter of acceptance or signed agreement. Okay. So that is the background for variation. So as we have discussed, definitely variation should be discussed together with the clauses. So in FIDIC, clause number 13 is the clause that will be covered variation. We will be looking at this at later part of this presentation. So under that clause, you can have idea what is the variation. So as per that, if there is anything newly added for your construction or to your existing design, that will be a variation. And if something has been removed from the existing original design, then that omission also can be identified as a variation. Or else, if you want to change something like changing material, as example, floor finishes, earlier it was there tile finish, now you want to have granite finish. So it is a change. So either addition, omission or changes will be identified as a variation. and because of variation, definitely your contract price will be changed. So normally we will be discussing with the initial contract price. So because of this variation, that initial contract price is going to be changed. So if it is addition, it will be increased. If it is omission, it will be decreased. Okay. And after issuing, taking over certificate. If you can remember, I think I have mentioned you where you are going to issue the taking over certificate. So normally taking over certificate will be issued at the end of practical completion or normal after the normal completion date. Once you have visited the project or once you have incept the project, if the employer is satisfied to take it over, then he can take over and contractor can hand over it. Then employer will issue the taking over certificate. So then once you have received the taking over or once you have issued the taking over, after that you cannot issue a variation. So means after the issuing of taking over, there will be a starting point of defect notification period. So in defect notification period, you cannot issue a variation because you have already taken your taking over certificate. Okay, so that is up to that extent you can issue a variation. Okay, but as per the condition of contract, it says the authority to issuing a variation or authority to initiating a variation is with the engineer. Contract for the project will be owned by the employer, but issuing of variation, that authority will be with the engineer. So employer cannot issue a variation, but that is not the normal scenario because employer is the god, ne? He owns the project, he invests the project. So if he cannot do a change as per his perspective, there's no point. So then normally employers also normally issuing the changes, issuing the instruction. Then as the contractor, what you have to do is, if the employer has issued any instruction to variation, then you have to go for the engineer and you need to get the in written confirmation from the engineer, because as per the contract you can only do the variation as per the instruction of engineer. So what will be happen if there is instruction from employer? Definitely, prior to do that instruction, prior to obey with that instruction, you have to go back to the engineer and ask or get the confirmation from him. Then only you can start those implementing of that variation. That is one of the key point in variation, that initiating of variation can be doing by only by the engineer. Employer also cannot initiate a variation. Okay, and this power, this authority has been given to the engineer under sub clause 3.3, instructions of the engineer. So under that sub clause, contractor cannot reject any of the instruction that has been given by the engineer without reasonable ground. So then he has to obey. So same thing will be applied for the variation as well. If the engineer has instructed to do a variation, if there is no reasonable ground. So reasonable ground in the sense, sometimes engineer has to do a change with some type of specific material, but you find out that particular material is not available in the market, and if you are trying to import, then it will be taking 3 months or 4 months, which is not practical to complete the project on time. Then you have to inform that thing to the engineer, mentioning, Mr. Engineer, I have tried to purchase this material, but it is not available currently in market. If I have to import it from this country, it will take this much of period. Please give me your consent. So you can raise back it to the engineer with reasonable ground. If the engineer feels to okay, if there is such issue, okay, then we will not undertake in this variation, or I will change that material into something else or something like that, then he can either stop that instruction, or either he can change his own instruction, or any modification he can be done. But anyhow, without informing him, without getting the consent of engineer, contractor cannot refuse the any of the variation. Okay, so through the contract, by signing these conditions of contract, contractor agrees to do the variation as well. So subclause 13 is the clause that is discussed about the variation, as we have discussed. So 13.1, try to vary, that is a subclause. I'll show that thing because of time gap. I will not go for that condition right now. So right to vary, so under this subclause that they have mentioned, until the issuance of taking over certificate, engineer can instruct the variation. And there are two basic ways that a variation can be happen. One thing is issue instruction straightly by the engineer. Engineer can straightly issue an instruction. Please do this thing. Please change this thing. Please omit this thing. Please change your program as per the schedule or something like that. He can directly instruct. That should be a in-written instruction. It should not be a verbal instruction. Verbal instruction in the sense at the evening, at a progress party or something, contractor will meet the engineer at a party. Then if the engineer give any instruction verbally to the contractor at that moment, that will not be considered as a formal instruction. So what you can do is you can directly reject it now. So then day after that day, he can go to the, or he can write to the engineer asking, Mr. Engineer, yesterday you have mentioned that I want to do this change. So please confirm that, something like that. Okay. So if it is verbal instruction, you need to get it done by in written format. Okay. So for in written instructions are only the formal instruction that we are normally considered, but if it is a verbal instruction, you have to get the in written consent. Okay. And there is another way that ask contractor to submit a proposal. So sometimes without directly giving the instruction, engineer can ask from the contractor to submit a proposal, or else a contractor can identify some change and he can prepare a proposal and give it to the engineer. So sometimes when contractors are receiving construction drawing, I hope you all know what is construction drawing. So just give you a brief introduction. Construction drawings are the drawing that will be issued by the engineer to the contractor to do the actual construction. So why we are issuing a construction drawing? Because tender drawings can be changed while developing the design. So then it is essential to issue a construction drawing. Okay. So then under that situation, you can have this. Contractor can submit the proposal as well. Okay. And contractor cannot get away from saying no, labor force or managerial staff or something. He cannot say that I don't have labors right now or something like that.
Madam, excuse me.
Yes.
Is this lecture is recording?
Yes. Not with this one. I just recording Pavit. Contractor cannot refuse any of the variation. And another important thing is, so I have explained you what is measure and pay, or remeasurement contract type of method, payment method. So under that payment method that we know, we will be measuring the actual quantity based on the construction drawing. So in that case, BOQ quantity can be varied while going on the project. So as example, masonry work quantity might be like 5000 square meters in the BOQ, but while going on the actual construction, it might be goes up to 5500 square meters. So then quantity has been changed, but it is not considered as a variation. But sometimes we have to consider that quantity variation also as a variation, but mostly each and every quantity variation will not be considered as a quantity variation. Sorry, each quantity variation will not be considered as a variation exactly. Okay, so and other thing is, another important thing is, contractor cannot omit any part of main work with the intention that he can give that work to another outside person. Just assume that initially employer supposed to give all the finishing work to the contractor as well. So then BOQ has been priced and they have agreed based on that situation. But while going on the construction, that employer feels that his rate for floor finishing is much more higher compared to the market rate. So he just negotiated with some other contractor, small contractor, and decided to give that floor finishes part to that kind of another person by omitting that floor finishes from this main contract. That is not legal. You cannot do such kind of things under variation. You cannot omit the work just because you need to give it to another party. Okay, so that thing should not be done. If such situation has been happened, then definitely contractor can raise a claim, or he can go for dispute resolution method, or he can go for litigation process. Okay, so with the perspective of, with the intention of giving to the work for another party, you cannot omit any of the work. So omissions can be done, something like that you feel that part is not necessary to have for this project, or else you are not in a financial sufficient level to cover up that part of the work, so then you are trying to omit that thing. That is obvious, that is okay, but you cannot give it to another person. Okay, and only it can instruct additional work if it is necessary for the permanent work only. So you cannot say each and every additional, you cannot instruct any of the work that you are available with your context as a variation. So as example, just assume that you have been given a construction of 15 story building for a particular contractor, and both party has been agreed, now work is been going on. So you just thought to have another 5 story building next to that in the adjacent land. So you just thought that these rates are quite good, so you don't want to go for another tendering procedure. So you can issue a variation to construct a new 5 story building adjacent to this land. So you cannot issue such kind of thing as a variation, because it is not necessary to do in order to complete that permanent work. Construction of a new building with another 5 stories will not be a variation for this 15 story building. Okay, such kind of instruction cannot be issued as a variation. But construction of a security house, or construction of a boundary wall, some kind of additional landscaping thing, so those things can be identified as a variation. Okay, so some case laws are there. You will be learning this thing under your contract law or something. Okay, and another important thing is, when it comes to omission, not for addition but for omission, since you are going to reduce the part of that your main contractors were, sometimes, as we have discussed, contractor was expected to cover up some part of his overheads through this project. That is normally contractor supposed to cover up some part of his head of his cost through this project. So then but because of your omission, he will be missing the overhead component. So then he can raise a claim separately to cover up that loss of overhead. I think we have discussed those things under claim session. So that thing can be happen when there is a omission. Okay. So and variation procedure is there. So normally procedure can be established for project wise. It is a very sometimes you can arrange a method within the project after discussion of with your employer, or the engineer can establish a process with discussion of engineer what we are going to do, what is the way of submission, what are the things that you are required to submission. So as my experience in my last project for a variation, that agreed process was once the contractor has received the variation instruction through a letter, then he will do the design change. So normally when there is a variation, there will be a design change. No? So it is design and build contract. So design responsibility was with the contractor. So then they basically, once they have received that instruction, they basically first they will do the design change. And then they are going to submit it to the engineer. Okay. So then they will analyze the thing. If it is practical, they will instruct to go ahead. If it is not practical or something like that, they just ask to stop that thing, okay, stop that variation. So in that sense, if they advise to stop that variation, then to develop that design, we have incorporated some designers, draftsmen and some other expertise. No? So for that, their timing cost or their allocation for that developing of that particular design, that cost will be covered from the engineer. If he instruct us to go ahead with the with that particular variation, then what we are going to do is then after the finalize of design, we will be doing cost proposal, and then the revised program also will be going to be submitted. So that is the procedure that they have agreed. It can be differ, but as per the contract document, it says you need to submit the cost proposal as soon as you receive the instruction. That is the normal scenario as per the conditions. Once you have received the instruction, you need to submit the cost proposal as soon as possible. But you have, though you have submitted the cost proposal, you cannot wait until it is going to be approved. Without approval, you have to start the work. Okay, so you cannot say, contractor cannot say, okay, my proposal has not been approved. I don't know whether my cost is going to be approved. I don't know how much they are going to pay for me. You cannot say something like that. Once you have received the instruction, you have to start. Okay, but you have to submit that cost proposal. So normally when it comes to government project for a variation, evaluation of variation also having another importance. So evaluation of variation we will discuss in another lecture, since we have dropped this lecture. So that thing I will be covering on next week. So but anyhow, you both parties need to come to a one conclusion that come to a one solution, but until that you cannot wait for start the work. So that is a normal variation procedure. And under variation, yes.
So when the employee not agree with that trades,
then
already the contractor has to
start the work.
Start now,
yeah,
so
might be finish the work already. So then that is why there is a something called claims and dispute resolution. Or something like that. If you cannot agree in between parties, you have to submit it as a claim, or else you can issue a claim whatever the arbitration notice or adjudication notice, and you can go ahead with those arbitration procedure, adjudication procedure, whatever as per the contract document. So that is the next step. but you cannot wait until you get the approval. Okay, so then there will be another mechanism. Then it will become a dispute, ne? Because both parties cannot come to a conclusion. Both parties cannot come to an agreement. So then there will be a dispute. So then with that dispute, you can go ahead with your claim procedure. So that is the way. So normally variations are the major component that will be contribute for the claims. Okay. So that is about variation, and I need to cover up some small thing again. Daywork. So daywork also coming under variation. It also covering in the variation clause. Daywork, it is a kind of specific thing. Daywork is so normally when there is a work, normally we will be normally the contractor is going to do that work and payment will be made based on the BOQ item, né? Using the rate or using the lump sum amount, payment will be done. But there are some items that you cannot pay under your main work item, or you cannot identify it as a variation because basically you cannot quantify that work. So you cannot quantify that work. So for a variation, there should be a counted, you know. So if it is a new construction of boundary wall, you can measure the concrete, you can measure the masonry, plastering, finishes and foundation thing, excavation, all the things you can measure, no? But when it comes to daywork, that is the case that where you cannot measure the whatever the quantity. So then it will become a daywork. So as example, that can employer want to demolish some part of your constructed wall. So when you are going to do a demolishing work, you cannot exactly say this exact to these lines you can demolish the thing. That is not possible. So normally when you are doing demolishing, some dimensions can be different, eh? So then in such a situation, you cannot get the volume or square meters or linear meters to measure that work. So then what you are going to do is, you will be paid under day work basis. So now word is there, how do you going to pay under day work basis? To pay under day work basis, there is a compulsory schedule going together with your BOQ that is called day work schedule. So if you want to do a work under day work, there should be a day work schedule. Okay, without day work schedule, you cannot instruct a day work. So what will be happen if you have instruct some work under day work, then what will be happen? So it might be like demolition work, or if there is any crack, you need to do some treatment for that crack. So once you have identified the crack, if you start do the treatment, you don't know when it will be finished. So as example, sometimes in waterproofing, if there are some leakages or something, then you are going to apply some chemicals like chemical jetting or something like that. So in such a situation, there is a requirement of some chemical amount. You don't know how much will it be, what is the inside of that wall regarding this waterproofing thing. So you will be inserting that chemical, inserting. So you cannot measure the volume, you cannot measure square meters or something like that. So it is a hidden thing. Or else sometimes you have need to excavate for a live cables. So live cables are going in your groundwork, so you have to excavate with those live cables. So then it might not be foreseen by the contractor. Once you have occurred such situation, you have to pay additional care, and it cannot be paid under normal excavation rate. It has not been predicted earlier as well. So in such a situation, it cannot be instructed as a variation because you cannot give a rate. So best way is instructor day work. So as I told you, day work schedule should be there. So under day work schedule, what you are going to do is you will contract, sorry, engineer will be giving some day work item like skill labor rate, skill labor, what is the rate for 1 hour? And skill labor, what is the rate for 1 hour? Cement, what is the rate for 1 cement bag? Blocks, what is the rate for 50 blocks? Bricks, what is the rate for 100 bricks? Or something like that. So there will be a given item and contractor will price in that. So when you are pricing as a contractor for a day work schedule, you need to make sure that skill labor rate is not the same labor rate that you are using for your rate analysis. For the day work schedule labor rates, you should incorporate that tools. You did not do your rate analysis. No? So normally tools is the thing that we are allocating for labors, like some kind of small equipments. So for a carpenter, saw or something, that is a tool for him. So something like small equipment, we will not be identified it as machinery category. So then it will be considered as tool. So for tool, you will be normally allocating 2% or 2.5% or 3% as per the given nature of the project. So that tools also, that allocation for tools also need to be within your rate. And sometimes profit margin, your overhead and profit margin also within this rate. So as example, that normal your skill labor day per day for skill labor, it will be like 3000 rupees per day. But when you are going to price that your day work schedule, it will not be 3000, it is definitely more than that, because you have to add some for tools and you have to add some part for overhead component and then add some part for profit or something like that. So then it will goes up to 3800 or something like that. Okay. So day work schedule is basically, it will be consist of major items, major basic items like material, labor and plant and equipment. So then what you are going to do is, once there is instruction for day work, what you have to do is both engineer person and the contractor person will be available at the site while you are carrying your day work. So what they are going to do is, they will maintain a record. Okay. How many labors have been worked? What is the labor day calculation? What is unskilled labor day calculation? How many cement has been used? How many bricks, blocks, water? Those things they are going to do, make a record basis. So each and every day, both parties need to sign under that record and need to confirm that this much has been used for this particular day work item. Then at the payment time, that agreed day work record need to be sent together with your interim evaluation. Then that rates will be allocated as per the day work schedule in the BOQ and payment will be done. So no additional overhead percentage or no additional profit percentage will be allocated. Okay. So, but you cannot, the specific thing is normally it says that day works rates are very high. So if there's no any other option only, you have to instruct a day work. Otherwise, don't instruct a day work. Better to go with the variation. But if there is a situation that you cannot quantify or something like that, then if there's no any other option, then you can instruct a day work and go ahead with day work schedule. So then major essential thing is that you are required to have a day work schedule. If there's no day work schedule, then you cannot pay. But the both parties are highly want to have a day work, to do a day work, then both parties can agreed for a day work schedule and then do the day work and make the payment based on that agreed schedule. Okay. So and for day recording purpose, standard format should be used. So normally both parties should be agreed for that format, but whatever the format, but this important thing is at the end of each day work record, both parties are required to be signed or certified. Okay. As a contract administrator, it is your responsibility to, if there is new change or new item, it is your responsibility to whether to instruct it in variation format or in a, as a day work format. So it is contract administrator's responsibility when it comes to engineer's part. Okay, so that is all about variation and day work. So hope you have kind of idea.